I pointed out that some of the expressions, for example, if I take the four divergence of a vector, can be simplified, and the expression we have derived for this was this, 1 over root minus g dA of root minus g j. I want to elaborate on this a little bit more and point out a few things which we will need. I pointed out that this is very natural because if I have an expression like integral d4x root minus g dA of jA, the root minus g here nicely cancels with this root g minus g, because of which this will go into exactly what I would have written down in special relativity without thinking. This is over a volume V and this is over the boundary of that volume. Okay. It works in the case of a vector, and I also pointed out that in the case of an anti-symmetric tensor the same expression holds. That is, if this JA was FAB, I could have just put FAB here and I could have gotten away with it. And the source of an anti-symmetric tensor field being a 4 vector sort of ties in with that. Now if I have this relation and I have chosen the surfaces to be, let us say T is equal to constant surface, then the NA will have only the time component even in general relativity. So you will have a J0 which you would have integrated out. That quantity will be a scalar. That is a scalar because root h d3x is a scalar, NA JA is a scalar. The dotting has to be done with GAB, full GAB. Now I want to get one more expression where this doesn't work, which is also going to be very important as we go along. Suppose instead of this JA, I had a second rank symmetric tensor. So I look at a tensor which I will call TAB, which is going to be eventually identified with an energy momentum tensor. I very briefly mentioned it in special relativity, but we will, as we go along, we will need this more and more. Suppose in special relativity I have an equation like this. This is in special relativity. Okay. So in special relativity I could have integrated this over a 4 volume d4x dA of TAB, which is of course identically 0, and I could have taken this integral using the Gauss theorem. And I could have defined, for example, an integral over d3x if I take it to be a t equals constant surface with t 0 b. Okay. Now let me just remind you of the physical meaning of TAB, because we went through it very rapidly when we did the special relativity. Just as an example, think of TAB due to a bunch of particles. So that is defined as, if you take TAB at any given point x, space-time point x, is defined as an integral over the momentum space d3p upon ep, this is the old notation which we used in special relativity. I took it as pa pb times the distribution function which depends on p and x. Just to remind you what it is, f with a vector p and a 4 vector x, this is t as well as x, y, z, gives you the number of particles in a small phase volume d3x, d3p, and I argued and showed you that that is Lorentz invariant concept. We also saw that d3p upon the energy p, which is square root of p square plus m square, is a Lorentz invariant object, so this entire structure is Lorentz invariant. Physically what it means is, can be seen by just taking the components. If I take T00, I will have zeros here, both of them are energies, so one energy term goes away, and you will have integral over D3P of energy times F. So this is just, this is the F d3p gives you the number of particles per unit volume, because momentum space is integrated out. So this gives you energy per unit volume. This is the energy density. Similarly, if you take T 0 alpha, one zero term will take that away, and you will end up getting d3p p alpha f, which is just the alpha times f, which gives you the total amount of momentum flux. So I could have combined these two and I could have just put a 4 vector a here. So that would have been T 0 a would have been like a PA, 4 momentum at any given place, energy density and momentum density. Similarly, if you look at the alpha beta component of that, there will be a P alpha by E, which is like the velocity, and then there is a P beta. So it is a velocity times momentum. So velocity times anything gives you the flux, and it gives you the momentum flux across a surface, which is like a force. Okay. So I won't even write it down. So these kind of structures can emerge very naturally in several systems. We will do this properly when we go to Einstein's field equation. That is why I didn't do it in greater detail. But this is a symmetric tensor, and this tensor will be conserved, because after all it is energy and momentum and things like that. So in special relativity I could have done this, and I could have sort of said that this quantity, where the T is equal to constant, actually stands for, you do it at T is equal to T2 and subtract from it T is equal to T1, and this should be 0, because this quantity is 0. Now that implies that if I do an integral over d3x of t0b, that object is a conserved quantity, and that conserved quantity is just the 4 momentum of the system or whatever. This unfortunately will not work in general relativity. Now the reason is very simple. If you take t0b, this has a vector index left. Ignore for a minute what happens with zero index. I mean that itself can create problem, but right now let us ignore that. It has a vector index. So for a, in some loose sense, it is like a 4 vector hanging around at some place. When you do a d3x, you are adding them at different places. Now we know that the 4 vectors at different places transform differently. Therefore you can't add them up and obtain a 4 vector. We did not run into that problem here, because we actually summed over a NAGA, which is a scalar. We could have played that same trick here. You could have written down a corresponding expression in general relativity. Then I would have got a NATA. So that is why I said that is not an issue. So it is a NATAB. That is a 4 vector. But it has a loose index hanging around. Because of that, it is like a 4 vector. And when you add them 4 vectors at different spatial location, that is not going to give you a covariant quantity. So we run into trouble with that. Now you may think that this is a minor issue and somehow we can sort it out. You can't. There is a serious reason why you cannot sort it out, which we will come to later on. But I want to ask, what happens to this equation in general relativity? So the natural generalization is, of course, this goes into TA of, nabla A of TAB equal to 0. So I would like to spend a moment and work this out, just as we worked out this expression for this, what this gives. Okay. That is, here when we took dA of JA, we had an expression entirely in terms of the metric, and I would like to obtain a similar expression for this. This turns out to be a little bit more messy algebra, but we will crank it through. So what this gives you is dA of TAB. So we had to just work out the covariant derivatives. It is better to work with this object. It turns out to be slightly simpler. So let me put 1b lower. It doesn't matter where I place this b, because it is symmetric. I can just lower it anywhere. So this is one correction. Then plus, I'm going to correct for a. So t and a gamma. A is what is being corrected. So a get replaced by a dummy index. B remains as it is, and the differentiating index is A, and you put a M here. Okay. then that is correcting for A, then I had to correct for B, so minus sine t and a gamma. I am correcting for lower index, which is m, A goes for a right, so there is a m here. Then the differentiating index is A and I should have a B, okay. This is our old front, okay. We had this result that gamma A m A, if I remember right, is dA of log root minus g. dm of log root minus g. So this will get replaced by that. So it is 1 over root minus g times a root minus g. We play the same game, multiply that by root minus g, etc. So those two terms together is going to give me 1 over root minus g dA of root minus g TAB. You know, if there were only these two terms present, we are through. It is very nice. It is just like this or antisymmetric tensor, etc. But there is an extra term present. That went away in the case of antisymmetric tensor because of some symmetries, but here it will not happen. So let us see what that is. So this is going to have a GM on top. So let me just write it down. Or you may be able to guess it from here itself. This is TME. Gamma m comma ba. Is it obvious to you? Because this m is obtained here by putting a gm some k. So that gm can be made to act on this m and rise it to k. So just that k will sit here. Now we want to think of what this is going to be. We know that this is symmetric in m and a. So if I expand this out, I will have half minus dm of GAB plus DA of GBM plus DB of GAM, right, which is contracted with a AM. So that AM term here is fine, we can't do anything. Here it is AM and a AM swapped with a different sign. Therefore, these two terms are not going to contribute in this. So I can just ignore these two and I am only left with that term. Therefore, this can be written as 1 over root minus g dA of root minus g TAB TAB minus half DB of GAM TAM. This is what you get. So this is the expression similar to this expression. This is as best as you can do, but that is good because you just have to evaluate one derivative of the metric. In these things, you don't have to evaluate any derivatives of the metric. Remember that Christoffel symbols involve evaluating 40 components. So anything which you can do, which will avoid having to evaluate Christoffel symbols are good, okay. So that is what why we are spending time doing this algebra. These things will turn out to be useful. So it also tells you something interesting. Suppose your metric happens to be independent of the B coordinate, so that dB of GAM is 0. Then you can go around integrating this and everything would be fine, because then the formula reduces exactly to this one, okay. For example, if the metric is independent of time, then we are talking about B is equal to 0. Then T0A can be integrated out and that will give you something like a four momentum, just as in this case where we worked this out, okay. Now we want to generalize this notion. So I want to spend some time explaining how this notion can be generalized, because that is going to lead again to a very nice geometrical object, which usually is introduced in a geometrical manner, but in the spirit of this course I am going to introduce it through a physics based discussion. So we have got this conservation law here in special relativity, but the moment you go to general relativity, this is not a conservation law, because conservation law by definition is that you can define some integrated quantity which does not change with time. Now this cannot be converted into that form because of this extra term. We had already seen why that is the case, that is because there is an extra thing hanging around which you cannot get out of. Now I will try to give you an argument as to a situation where this might work, and then we will see what it implies. So let me do it here. Let us assume that I have some vector, 4 vector, which I will call psi A. It is a vector field, there is a vector at every point, and I take this vector and I construct the quantity TAB, it does not matter, I can put both of them on top, TAB psi B. Okay. The roughly the idea is coming from the fact that suppose this vector is in the direction of time. Suppose the vector has 1, 0, 0, 0 kind of components, okay, and suppose the metric is independent of time, then this dot product which I am taking here is equivalent to just picking that 0 component out of that, which I know is conserved. So in some sense this is giving me a hope that maybe I can come up with a conservation law, and it turns out that hope is actually can be realized. Now consider dA of this quantity. Now dA of TAB is going to give me 0, so the only thing I need to worry about is this is equal to TAB dA psi B. Okay. Suppose I can choose a psi B, the vector, such that this expression vanishes. Now can you tell me what could be a logical reason for this expression to vanish? I mean some elementary situation, I mean it can vanish in different cases. So one simple way to make it vanish, can you think of something? Well, what do you do is to use the fact that this is symmetric in A and B, therefore if this is anti-symmetric in A and B, then you are through. So we choose psi B such that dA psi B plus dB psi A is equal to 0. Okay. Now the idea is the following. I said start with some vector. Now I have put a condition on that vector. Okay. This is actually quite interesting, so let us spend some time on that. You are given a metric. You have sitting in some curved space time. Now I am going to write down a differential equation for a vector field, where of course all these covariant derivatives etcetera will tell you how the gammas and derivatives of the metric affect that equation, and you solve this and suppose you find a solution for a psi A. You may not even get a solution, but suppose you have a sensible solution for that psi A. Then I know that this quantity can be made to vanish. That is good, because now what I can do is I can do integral root minus g d4x, which is again complicated way of writing 0, root minus g d4x of this dA of TAB psi B. But now this is just a vector. We have reduced the problem down to this j, that is psi B is contracted out, this is just a vector, therefore this can be written as integral root minus g d4x, there is just a vector index left, so it is 1 over root minus g dA root minus g TAB psi B. So nicely root minus g and root minus g will cancel, etcetera, etcetera. So I have a conservation law.
I can write down the conservation law as integral d3x, just as in the case of ji, root h some n a t a b psi b. That expression is completely general covariant, because that now it is a scalar which I am integrating over another scalar. So the you can obviously see the trick. If there are no hanging loose indices, then you are fine. So we remove the hanging loose index by taking it dotted it with psi. But of course, when you dot it with psi, the conservation law will not hold except when this satisfies. So you suddenly realize that vectors which satisfy this equation is going to play a very key role. Okay. So this equation is called killing equation. Try to remember the capital in K, nothing murderous. So this is and this vector is called a killing vector. It will play a very important role in what we are going to do. Now nothing guarantees you that a killing vector will exist in a space time. Okay. Because it is allowing you to give a conservation law, you can immediately see that the killing vectors are somehow connected with the fact that some dB of GAB is equal to 0 kind of a condition. So the metric should be independent of some coordinates, which is what leads to conservation law. So there must be some symmetry in the metric for this to hold. The simplest kind of symmetry which you can think of is that you take the space time. Suppose you have a metric, let us say GAB, which is independent of time. So GAB of t comma x is actually just GAB of x. It is not dependent on time. Now suppose I take I do xa going to xa plus the same killing vector kind of a thing psi a, where psi a is some 1 or rather epsilon 0 0 0. What does this mean? What it means is that I am taking my original coordinates and I am shifting the coordinates, translating the coordinates by an amount. I am leaving the spatial coordinates alone, and time coordinate I am going up by an amount epsilon. I put epsilon so that it is just an infinitesimal translation. I could have even put 1 there, it does not matter. So when I am doing that translation, I know that metric does not change, because metric is independent of time. So this just maps the space-time onto itself, and that is a symmetry. So in that sense, a translation like this with this, when GAB is of this kind, is a symmetry, and this better be a killing vector. You can explicitly verify that if you take this, plug it into this, and use the condition that this is independent of time, that this equation is satisfied. Now that is a bit non-trivial, because you have to work through all the components and make sure that it vanishes, which it will. Okay. But I am going to now give you a general proof of that in a slightly different way, and that is going to be an interesting thing by itself. What I want to ask is the following question. Forget for the static or any such thing. I want to concentrate on this kind of a transformation, where xa goes to some xa plus psi a of x, with psi a being treated as infinitesimals of first order. If you are a purist, you will put an epsilon in front of this and you will think of epsilon going to 0 limit at all the calculation, epsilon square, epsilon cubed, you will ignore. We won't be a purist, we will just think of psi a's as infinitesimals by themselves. Okay. So you have something like this, and we want to ask, under such a shift, how does the functional form of the metric change? Okay. What happens to GAB if I make it? Think of this as a coordinate transformation, infinitesimal coordinate transformation, and I want to know how GAB changes. What I will show is that in general, under such a transformation, that is, if xa goes to xa plus psi a of x, the GAB's functional form changes as delta GAB. It is nicer in terms of contravariant dA psi b plus dB psi a. This is going to take some work and you can get lost in algebra. So, for the moment assume that I prove it. Let us look at the physics of it and then come back to that. So, under such an infinitesimal transformations, I can show that delta GAB changes by this amount. That is, GAB goes to GAB plus delta GAB, where it is given by this. Now, go back to this. If this is 0, what it means is that under XA going to XA plus IA, the metric does not change. That is a symmetry for me, and that is what leads to, for example, this conservation law. And there will be a host of conservation laws which will come about if such a killing vector exists in the space time. Okay. Now, why do I have to do this in such a funny way? Why cannot I just say something like this, that GAB is independent of time, so there is a symmetry? The problem has to do with coordinates. In general, you do not know what is the most natural coordinate system for the metric, and the metric may be given to you in some given coordinate system, because you solved Einstein's equation in some coordinate system which turned out to be convenient. There could be hidden symmetries, where if you go in some particular direction psi a, the metric does not change, but that would not be obvious in the coordinates. Okay. If a metric is explicitly static in a coordinate system, then you can figure it out, but in general it would not be obvious. So, you would like to characterize the symmetries of the space time in terms of the independent killing vectors which will exist in the space time. It is somewhat like doing Kepler problem in Cartesian coordinates. Suppose I write down the Lagrangian for Kepler problem in Cartesian coordinates. I mean, all the x, y, z, everything is present and you do not see any symmetries inside. But if you do it in r theta phi coordinate system, I can immediately see that one angular coordinate is ignorable. There is an angular momentum conservation. So, in the same sort of way, the coordinate system which you have chosen may hide the symmetry of the metric. So, it is better to have an independent way of thinking about it, and that is what this gives. Okay. Now, we will try to work this out. So, what we are going to do is the following. We have done XA going to XA plus psi A of x, which we will call XA prime or X prime A. Okay. And we want to know how the metric changes. So, the metric will change to G prime AB at X prime. We know in general it is D of XA prime by DXI, D of XB prime by DXJ, GIJ of X. I just want to emphasize the x and x prime, which is usually not written for a reason very soon. What it means is that at the same physical location, the components of GAB rotates among themselves. That is what this says. But this x is maps to this x prime. The numerical values will be different. Suppose this x was some in one particular coordinate had a value 1, this will have a value 3. But in the new coordinate, the point with x is equal to 3 corresponds to in old coordinates the point with 1. This is not what we want. We want to change in the functional form, but we will come to that. So, this is equal to g I j, and we have to write these down. X prime with respect to x a, you go back to this. So, that is going to be delta a I plus from this d I of psi a. Okay. Then you have another term like this, which is delta b j plus d j of psi b. Now we expand it out. So we get, we have to retain only up to linear order in psi. So the first term is of course trivial, it is g a b of x. Then we will pick one term from this and this. So let us say g j is replaced by b, so it is g I b. Okay, so I have picked this, so I had picked this d I of psi a. Then similarly the other term where I becomes a, g a j, so I picked this and I had picked that d j of psi b, correct. So this is to order psi square, psi square terms are ignored. Okay, this is what we have. Now this is, as I said, is the expression for g a b x prime and g a b at x. But what we want is how the functional form of g a b changes. So to do that I have to actually write this as g prime of a b at x prime, which is x plus psi, and do a Taylor series expansion in that. So that is going to give me g prime of a b at x plus, let us say, xi k d k of g a b. Okay. What we want to compare is this g prime of a b at x with g a b at x. I should not even say x, g a b as a function of x and g prime a b as a function of x. We want to see how that functional form has changed. Okay. So let us look at that. So g a, this quantity minus this quantity is what I am going to call delta g a b. Which one? Yeah, that is correct, absolutely. Yeah, that is because within this I do not have to do it, any tele, this is already linear order in psi. What is x prime?
G prime a b at x plus
I. Is
g prime a b at x.
Right.
Epsilon k daba k g prime a b.
This is no, this is d k xi k of g a b. Now what is the problem here? This is, think of this as some point, generic point like this. You have taken the value at x, then you are doing a Taylor series expansion. So this times derivative of this with respect to that.
Yeah, but that should be a g prime, right?
This should be a g prime. Is that what you are saying?
Yeah.
That is what I am trying to tell you, that this g prime and g differ by an infinitesimal order.
Oh, okay.
Since I am multiplying by psi, that is g.
Yeah.
Okay. So to the lowest order, this is correct. So if you want to be very, very precise, this is this. Yeah. Okay, so delta g a b is this g prime of a b minus this g a b. So I am going to bring that to this side and move everything to the other side. So let us see what I get. G I b d I of psi a plus g I a d I of psi b. I have, instead of j I have called it I, and I have just flipped it to make it all look symmetric. This is a b and that is b a. Then I have to subtract from it some xi k d k of g a b. So this is what you have. Now this may not look like what it should be, but it turns out that this expression is identically equal to what I wrote down here. Okay. So this is best done by working this through and comparing with that, and I will indicate how to do that, and I will leave the rest of it for you to work out. So let us look at the right hand side of this. Okay, the here what you have is the expressions in terms of all kinds of size up and down, etc., but they will all match out properly. Okay, so I will just work that out. So what we want to do is to calculate dA of psi b, and then once I have got it, I can symmetrize it. Okay, I just have to do it for some a and b, and then I can flip a and b. So this will be some g a k d k of psi b, because we only know how to do this with a k at the end, and you have to rise it up. So this will be g a k, you expand it out, so you have a d k of psi b plus, we have done this several times now, you must all be experts in Christoffel symbols. So this is k some I psi I. Okay. So we are almost there, but not quite. So we have this quantity, and when I symmetrize it, I am going to get this A and B symmetrized with one contraction on k. Now you find that this is exactly what that is. There is a one contraction in I, which I could have called k, and there is a and b which is symmetrized. So this term is going to take care of two of the terms there. Now I only need to know what that second term is going to do. Okay, so let us work out the second term. So the second term is g a k g b c half gamma, no half, okay, I will write it as c I k xi I. I just rise this b using a g b c and put a c at the bottom. So this is going to be g a k g b c psi I, now comes the half minus dc of gik plus di of gck plus dk of gci. Okay, this is the term which we have, and in this term you have a and a b, and I have to symmetrize with respect to a and a b. That is, I have to write down exactly the same term with a and b interchange, and I have to add them up, because remember that this is a of a b, I am supposed to find the sum like this. Okay, let me wait and make sure it sinks in. See, one thing which is going to happen in GR is that you have to do these sort of computations day in and day out. I mean, God forbid, you probably should choose some other area. So if you want to work in this area, you have to do that, and it is good to be able to see the patterns ahead of time, so that you don't have to compute everything. Because as I told you, I just write down this, then I know that I have to interchange A and B and add. So already I see that there is one term here which, when I interchange and add, is going to take care of two of the term. All that I have to prove is that the other term is going to give me this. Then I am through. When I add to it, it should give you that. Okay. So that is actually quite easy. So that is why I am just going to argue using plain English. So you have this expression, and I am going to interchange A and B and add. But interchanging A and B is the same as interchanging K and C, right? So let us look at this and see what will happen if I interchange K and C. Again, nicely, you have a K and C sitting here, K C here and a C K here. So when I interchange and add, that is going to go away. So the only term which is going to contribute is this middle term, right? So what I am going to get in that combination Okay, so the only term which is going to contribute in, I can put a line below A and B, which is my notation that I am symmetrizing in A and B. You won't find it in any other textbook. I just invented that notation to explain it here. So I am symmetrizing in A and B, which means this half will go, and this term and this term will go away, right? So what you are left with is minus psi I G A K G B C. No, no minus, plus G A K G B C, then D I of C K. This we did last time. This is our old friend. You see, if I have a D I of C K and I raise my C and K to this A and B, then I know that this whole thing is minus of D I of that. This is equal to minus psi I D I of G with the upper index with C K rise to B A. This we proved yesterday. That is, the derivative of the contravariant tensor is the derivative of the covariant tensor with the index raised with an extra minus sign thrown in. Remember that G A B C G B C Kronecker delta, that argument. So this is exactly the last term which you have. So it is very cute. This final answer is just D A of psi B plus D B of psi A. This is actually turns out to be extraordinarily important concept, both geometrically and physically. So you should understand that properly. So let me summarize what we have done. I said I am living in some space-time, I am given a metric. Then I ask, I am going to do a coordinate transformation, infinitesimal coordinate transformation, where my x a goes to x a plus I a, and I ask that the functional form of the metric does not change. So I work out the functional form change in the metric, and I find that it is given by this. So if this is equal to 0, then delta GAB vanishes. We will keep using this fact that delta GAB changes like this when you make an infinitesimal coordinate transformation. We will need this again and again and again, so you should remember that. And the rule is, if you use a plus sign here, then the contravariant components go with a plus sign. How do covariant components go? What is delta GAB? That will be minus dA of psi B plus dB of psi A. This sometimes comes as a bit of a confusing surprise to people, but it shouldn't. The reason this happens is that you are thinking of this as the matrix inverses of each other. So if I take GAB, GBC, that has to be Kronecker delta. Now if I do a delta on that, the delta of this and the delta of this should be inverted. Never think of delta GAB as a tensor obtained by lowering the indices on this. It is not. Okay? So that it's a bad notation. I mean, people write it like this. So when you think about this as a tensor which is lowered, you would have thought that, hey, well, this is a nice tensor equation, so I can lower the indices. You will miss a minus sign. Okay? So this is correct, and you can work it out. I mean, you could have worked out everything with lower indices and you would have got the correct result anyway. So this is how these things change, and these two results you need to know. And every once in a while you will get confused which one goes with the plus sign. So the thing to remember is, and also there are other textbooks where people will put this with a minus sign. Okay. So the way to remember is that if you shift xa to xa plus something, contravariant picks up a positive thing. And as I said, there are a few things in this course which you have to commit to memory. This is one of them. And this proof goes through this argument using the identities which we have used. The idea that this equation holds to 0 is it sort of encoding the symmetry of the space-time is what you should carry home with. That you cannot simply take a space-time and say that it something is independent of the coordinate. If that happens, well and good. But usually you will find that a nice coordinate system is not chosen and you will have things like this. And in fact, when people want to study about space-times with certain symmetries, suppose you say that a space-time should have spherical symmetry. We will see examples of that, that the spherically symmetric space-time can be written in weird coordinate systems where the spherical symmetry is not apparent. So the way to think about this is, what do I mean by spherical symmetry? In spherical symmetry, loosely speaking, there are some r equals constant surfaces in which I can slide in theta and phi directions and nothing should change. So the sliding in theta and phi direction, which is our intuitive concept, I mean, why do I say something is spherical? Because if I rotate it like this, it shouldn't change. That is sliding a coordinate to something else. Is exactly what this is. Okay? You are sliding the coordinate system and you are saying that something doesn't change. And that leads to a conservation. Okay. So that is all I wanted to say about the special formulas, etc. Now we will go and work out one more concept called parallel transport, and once we have done that, we are ready to take on curvature. Okay. So let me explain this idea of parallel transport. When we started out on these Christoffel symbols, we had this notion that you have a coordinate system here, which we took to be x and y, and we talked about unit vectors. Suppose I had a unit vector here, which was in ex direction. And there is another unit vector here which was in EY direction. Then I kept saying that if I go here, this is EY and this is EX, and these unit vectors are parallel to each other. This is fine if I have a global Cartesian coordinate system. In all other cases, this idea fails. I mean, I can't just sort of visually say this is true or not. Okay. Just to sort of illustrate this idea in a very sort of dramatic fashion, let us think of the surface of a sphere. So we have a sphere here. Think of it like Earth. We have one longitude, another longitude, and an equator. Okay. Now suppose I take a vector here, which is a tangent vector to this longitude, and I want to transport it parallel to itself to, let us say, a longitude of 90 degrees. Think of this as longitude of 0 and this as longitude of 90 degrees. Now what do I mean by parallel to itself? In this particular case, I can define it in a somewhat more rigorous way. Take the vector which is the tangent vector to the equator. Now I know that this angle is 90, right? Fortunately, the circle, the equator, is a great circle, and the geodesics on the surface of a sphere are great circles. Okay? Now this is pretty obvious, but if you solve the geodesic equation, you will get that. But sheer symmetry tells you that it has to be the great circle. Therefore, if this tangent vector to the great circle is taken, which is a tangent vector to a geodesic, that by definition parallel transports itself here. Therefore, the tangent vector to the great circle here, the equator here, is parallel to itself. Now if this is perpendicular to it, and if I draw here another thing which is perpendicular to this, then again I have an intuitive notion that if two things are perpendicular to each other and one is moved parallel to itself, the other is also moved parallel to itself. So this sort of rides on the back of this, and you have got it here. Now I have got another great circle here. Therefore, I can take this vector and parallel transport itself here. So I get that vector at this point. And similarly, I can take this vector and parallel transport it here. I'll get this vector. Now what we have done is the following. I have taken a vector, parallel transported it itself to here, parallel transported it back here, then parallel transported it back here, and I found the vector has changed. Okay. This is the intuitive way of understanding curvature, and we will make it more mathematical and we will see that this is a good way to understand curvature. is there a on the length of this root? Now it turns out that in particular spaces, if geodesics cross, then if you take some weird path, this cannot be well defined. But in principle, there is no restriction on the length of the root. I am going to give you a definition very soon as to how to parallel transport any vector around any curve. I'm going to do that in a minute. On a sphere, any point is north pole. Yeah, that is true, because I can draw longitudes from anywhere, so it doesn't matter. You could have, I didn't say where it, this is. This is not the axis of rotation or any such thing. I could have chosen any point and I could have played this game. All that I need is three great circles on the sphere. They cut at 90 degrees here, let us say, which would be convenient, and another great circle which cuts it at 90 degrees at these two points. No, geodesics are defined by integral ds from some x1 to x2 being extremized. That gives you an equation. Nobody assured you that the solution to the equation is unique. If you take two antipodal points on the sphere, there are infinite number of geodesics connecting them. But if you take two other points which are not antipodal points, you may have a unique geodesic. So if you take, as I said, in certain curved geometries, the geodesics can cross, and they need not cross in such a symmetric way as in a sphere. So there is a question as to which curve you are going to choose. But in principle, I can parallel transport any vector on any curve. I will give you a mathematical definition of that, and that would work. So there is, the answer to your question is there is no restriction on the length of the curve. But in general, when you close a loop, the vector will not come back to itself. But if I do that in a flat space time, again intuitively, it will come back to itself. Now, can I make this notion more precise? Yeah. Right. Close what? Right. Yes. Yeah, there can be curves in which it come back to the same position. That is not question. What is being said is that there are integrals on which it will not, but in a flat space time or in a flat space, it will always come back to itself. How do I know that? Because if I take a flat space and I use some crazy coordinate system here, and I have a vector somewhere, what I do is the following. Because it is flat space, I have a global Cartesian coordinate, then I can move vectors around keeping the components with respect to this Cartesian coordinates intact. That would be my definition of a parallel transport. So in a flat space time, there is that concept, but it is not there in a curved space time. But what I wanted to illustrate is something slightly different. Now suppose I chose two coordinates. It's a slightly mad thing to do, but there is nothing which forbids you in principle from doing that. This is theta and phi on the surface of a sphere. So theta goes from 0 to pi. And phi goes from 0 to 2 pi. Okay? So let us look at this vector. This vector is in the theta direction, so it is pointing in the theta direction, and it is at, by our definition, it is at phi is equal to 0, okay? But theta is equal to pi by 2. I mean, theta is equal to, yes, pi by 2. So take theta is equal to pi by 2, phi is equal to 0, which is this point. And in this point, you choose a vector which is along the theta direction. This is what this vector is. Okay? Then I am going to move this along the equator, which means that I am keeping theta constant and around phi. So I go from here to some point, let us say up to pi by 2. I move by 90 degrees, let us say. So it moves here. Okay, so that is this point. So this is A is here, and I move it here. This is B. Okay, then I am going to move it back to this point, which is theta equals 0, and let us say phi is equal to 0 and theta is equal to 0. That is like origin. Okay, or I could have thought of it as 2 pi. So in which case you move this here. then you can move it back here and move it here. It looks as though it has just come back to itself. Okay. What is wrong is this diagram. This diagram assumed that theta and phi are some globally defined Cartesian like coordinates, which it is not. Okay. So, in the same way, just because I drew an x and y does not mean and put unit vectors like this, does not mean that you can have a parallel transport which will not change anything. So, this is what I wanted to tell you, that the coordinate systems and depiction of coordinate systems in some flat blackboard can play tricks on you. Okay. You have to actually imagine that if there is a curvature, then the things can happen which is non-trivial. So, that was the main point I want to illustrate here. Now, let us go and define the concept of parallel transport a little bit more rigorously. So, I will again use the coordinate system. I won't even bother to say what these coordinates are. They are not Cartesian. That is what I have said, like theta and phi, it could be some crazy coordinate system. So, maybe I should actually call this x1 and x2, so that you don't think in terms of Cartesian coordinates. Now, I am given some curve in that, and the curve is parameterized by some parameter lambda. And I am also given some vector here at this point, where let us say lambda is equal to 0. And I am told, can you move this parallel to itself to some other value of lambda along this curve? Okay. So, I will try to give you a reasonable definition by which this can be done. So, the definition is the following. Given this curve xi of lambda, I can obtain a tangent vector dxi by d lambda. Okay. Let me call this some vi. Now, consider the equation. Vi lambda I of let us say some kj equal to 0. This is an equation which has to be solved for this vector kj. Xi is given, so Vi is given, so you know this Vi, you know the matrix, so you know the covariant derivative operator. So, I am writing down an equation for an unknown quantity kj. Now, I claim that this is a reasonable definition of a parallel transport, and that is obvious, because what I am saying here is that the change of kj along vi is 0. So, it is not changing as I move along, which is the components are not changing, which is the definition of parallel transport. So, let us say what this means. So, this is going to tell me that d xi by d lambda, which is what vi is, then you have a di of kj plus gamma j I l k l equal to 0. The way it has to be worked out in practice is that this di of kj into dxi by d lambda is going to tell you that I can define a d kj by d lambda plus gamma j l I k l d xi by d lambda equals 0. Let me try to explain to you what this equation means. You are given a curve xi of lambda. So, this is our original curve xi of lambda. You know the metric. So, you know gamma everywhere in space. In particular, you know the gamma along the curve. So, I can express gammas as a function of lambda. Because gammas are functions of xi, you take it along the curve. So, gammas are as a functions of L. Xi is already a function of lambda. So, this is an ordinary differential equation for a very with an independent variable lambda, and the solution to this will give you kj of lambda. It will require one initial condition because it is a first order equation. So, at lambda equals 0, you have to tell me what that vector is, that is given to you, correct. So, this is the answer to your question. You give me any curve you like and a vector anywhere on that curve, I will just write down this differential equation, I will solve it, and this equation always have at least one solution, and that solution will give me what this kj of lambda is. So, at lambda equals 1, if I want to know what the parallel transported vector is, it gives you that, okay. Of course, this also tells you that the geodesics parallel transports its tangent vector along itself, which we have done already several times. What is not clear from this and which is going to occupy all our time is that now suppose you give me another curve, okay, which goes like this. And I parallel transport, the endpoints are fixed, and I parallel transport the same vector along that curve. That is, I solve this differential equation now with a different dxi by d lambda and along a different track. Will I get the same result or not? Okay. Now, we have seen the example in the case of a sphere with explicit construction that in general you will not. So, again, extending your question, given a curve and a vector, you can always parallel transport it, whatever is the length. But there is no guarantee that if somebody changes the curve, keeping the endpoints fixed, he will end up getting the same value. In flat space time, we know it will happen. Why do I know that? Because this equation I wrote down is generally covariant. If somebody has guaranteed you that the space time is flat, I could have chosen a coordinate system which is Cartesian in which gammas are 0. So, I could have integrated this and I know that there is a unique solution. So, what we are going to ask is what is the condition under which such an equation will give me a unique solution, okay. Now, I have already written it in such a way to motivate that. You look at this. The part where the curve comes in is essentially here and indirectly through this xi of lambda. Now, suppose for a minute this itself can vanish, where now the derivatives are taken with respect to the coordinates dkj by dxi, no curves, no lambdas. Suppose I can integrate that equation, then I know that there is a way of parallel transporting with the vector in the space time independent of the curve. So, the condition which I want to impose is that this equation should have a unique solution. Now, why is it difficult? I will tell you why it is difficult. That equation tells you that k di of kj is equal to minus gamma j li kn. This is what that equation tells you. Now, these differential equations, these partial differential equations has certain things called integrability conditions under which the solution will exist, otherwise solution will not exist. The elementary reason is that if I take another derivative here with respect to some m, I will get a derivative of m on the right hand side. Then if I flip m and I, it better give me 0. That gives me a condition on this. In general, it will not work. So, we have to impose a condition that the partial derivatives commute, okay. So, I will show you why, when it will work and when it will not work. There is a, if you are geometrically oriented, there is another way of thinking about this. Forget this d lambda for a minute. Then it says dkj is equal to some gamma j li kl dxi, right. So, let me just write that down. Dkj equal to minus gamma j li kl dxi. Think of it as some thermodynamics. Xi's are some volume, temperature, etcetera. So, kj's are functions of that. So, you are calculating d of that quantity and this xi is summed over. So it is something into D of something, something into D of something, something into D of something. Suppose the right hand side is given to you, there is no guarantee that left hand side will be a D of some quantity. Okay, there is a strong condition under which it will hold and otherwise it will not hold. So I can write anything as DKJ, that does not mean a KJ will exist. Okay, so that is what is going to happen. So there is a condition that such a thing will exist, and that is what we want to figure out. So I want to do that, and that would require again some space. So let me do it here. Okay. So what we have is this equation, which I am going to start with, di of kj is equal to minus gamma j I l kl, and I want to look at the integrability conditions for this. So I am going to look at d, let us say m di of kj. So I have to differentiate that quantity. So that will be minus dm, let me write this as I and L here, it will turn out to be more useful later on that way. So dm of gamma j I L times KL minus gamma j I L dm of KL. No, but I already know what is derivatives of these are. So dm of kl I am going to substitute in terms of this relation again. Okay, so that is going to be first a minus sign that takes care of this, and dm of kl will be gamma dm of kl is again some p kp. This is a bit nice because first of all you find that it is linear in k, it does not have derivatives of k lurking around because I could eliminate that. Okay. The fact that it is linear in k is also interesting because if I do it for some 1 k1 and 1 k2 and I add them up, it will satisfy for others. So here I want to change this L to P so that I can write this whole thing as Kp multiplying from outside. Okay. Now I flip m and I and subtract the one from the other. So dm of di minus di of dm, which consistency requires is 0, kj. So I had to start with one term and then subtract the other. So it is minus dm of gamma I jp minus di of gamma m jp plus gamma, let me write it like this, gamma m l p gamma j I l minus I and m interchanged gamma l I p gamma j M L kp. Okay. So this quantity has to vanish. So this entire expression we will call capital R. So there is an M and an I in which I have flipped. I am trying to use a consistent set of notation because there are different notations for this, but I will try to do it in this way, and if there is a problem we will sort it out. And then I put a P and there is a J on top and is contracted on P. This is the definition. So let us again pause for a minute and see what this means. I have kept this minus sign, and the way it is defined is that there is a 4 index symbol. This index is eventually going to be lowered, so I have kept a slot for it to be lowered. There are J and P which are like matrix indices, and this M and I which are like space time indices, think like that. So think of M and I, then you have a dm of gamma I minus di of gamma m. The matrix indices will take care of themselves. Then I have a m times I. So this is the matrix multiplication with a summation over this. The remaining index is ji. So this is m times I and this is I times m. Okay. So roughly speaking, you could have thought of this as kp. I will leave that slot vacant here, and this is like dm of gamma I minus di of gamma m plus gamma m gamma I commutator. Okay. So obviously there are two indices left out here. Those two indices has to come out as matrix indices. There is a column vector which is multiplying it on the whole. So this matrix index here is dm of gamma I, di of gamma m, commutator of gamma m. The reason I wrote it like this is long back I told you that if you ever do gauge field theory, then the gammas will appear like connections. They are the connections, and in gauge theory also there will be connections. And then it will turn out that the I is still going to be space-time index. Unless someone is completely crazy, usually in normal gauge theories, I is a space-time index, and these are going to be the internal group indices. That is what is happening here. So if I had just written it as AI, this would have been what is known as a Yang-Mills theory. Okay, and this is the curvature of that Yang-Mills theory: dm of AI minus di of AM, and a commutator AM AI. The commutator comes about because you are working in a matrix representation. So that is exactly the structure which we have, and this quantity is called a curvature tensor. It is called either Riemann-Christoffel tensor or a curvature tensor. I have not yet proved rigorously that it is a tensor. I will prove that in a minute, okay, but it is going to be a tensor. I mean, yeah, that is what I am going to do, okay, but there is a slightly nicer way of doing it, but let us get back to that. But let us look at the structure again. What we have found is that this dm di minus di dm of kj can be expressed in terms of a quantity which is defined entirely in terms of gammas times that kp. So consistency, that there should exist a vector field in the space time when parallel transported in a unique way, that is, it should be independent of the curve on which you are being parallel transported, and it should globally exist, is equivalent to this quantity is vanishing. Okay, and we already said that in flat space time they are going to vanish, because in flat space time I can have this curve independence for parallel transport. So this quantity is going to vanish in flat space time. And if it vanishes in flat space time in one coordinate system, it better vanish in any other coordinate system, because I know that I can do this parallel transporting. So it looks very much like an object which, if it vanishes in one coordinate system, vanishes in all other coordinate systems, and it has indices, it is likely to be a tensor. Okay. But I will give you a more rigorous definition that it is indeed a tensor. because gammas are not tensors, it is not obvious from the look of it that whether it is going to be a tensor or not. Now look at the structure of that. We originally started with a metric. Derivatives of the metric gave you the Christoffel symbols. These are one further derivatives of the Christoffel symbols. So these are second derivatives of the metric, and you go back to your idea that metric is like the potential. G naught naught is 1 plus 2 phi. Christoffel symbols are like forces. These are derivatives of the forces. Now in normal Newtonian gravity, I mean, you should have been taught, but nobody ever teaches derivatives of the forces. Okay, and it will turn out that the derivatives of the forces is what actually quantifies curvature. Remember those two balls which are dropped and both are going towards the center of the earth. So the force here and force here, if they are identical, then it is an accelerated frame. If the force here and force here are not exactly identical, then it tells you that it is moving like this, there is curvature in space time. So the derivative of the force being non-zero is what indicates the curvature, and that is what this will characterize. Okay. So once you have this term vanishing, we then know that you can do a unique parallel transport and establish this. In particular, if a coordinate basis is given to you, suppose basis vectors are given to you at one point and you are told this tensor vanishes, then you can take any curve you like and parallel transport the basis vectors everywhere. So you have a global basis. Therefore, if a metric is given to you, the nicest way to figure out whether it is flat or curved is to go and calculate this Riemann-Christoffel tensor or the curvature tensor. Okay, if all the components of it vanishes, it will be most laborious way of finding out zeros. If all of them vanish, then you know that the space-time is flat. Okay, there will be some coordinate system in which it will become eta ab dxa dxb. Now you may think it is a dumb way to do that, but it is a constructive way. A computer can do it for you. Okay, so you don't need any smartness. So it will work. I mean, given that metric, you can calculate it, and if any one component is non-zero, you know the space-time is cut. You only have to run the program until you find one non-zero component. I mean, as long as you are interested in knowing whether it's flat or cut. Okay. So earlier on, I told you that given a metric, the usual way to think about this is to think of coordinate transformations to make it whether it is flat or not. But there you never know whether you are smart enough to have not found it or whether it is actually not flat. But here there is no such things, and you can compute that out. I think this is a good place to stop, and then I will take up various properties of this, and I will also give you a proof that this is actually a tensor in a more formal way where it will not leave any doubts. Okay, and then we will work out its various properties. Okay, I think we can stop here. Any questions on this? Why did I take the double derivative? No, I didn't. No, the way to think about this is the following. This is the differential equation to which I want a solution. If I have a unique solution to this differential equation, then I know that the space, I can parallel transport a vector along any curve from point A to point B, and the vector which I get at B will be the same. Now I want a condition for that. So the condition is the same as this partial differential equation having a unique solution. That condition is this double derivative with m and I and with I and m should be 0, okay? Because the most important part of this derivation is this is 0. I mean, this is by definition 0. By definition of partial derivative, it is 0. So if the right hand side is not 0, something is wrong, right? So suppose the right hand side in general will not be 0. If I take some arbitrary metric and compute this, this will not be 0. So the question is, what is wrong? Suppose the right hand side is not 0 while the left hand side we expect to be 0. What is wrong? What is wrong is that these differential equations do not possess a solution. And this differential equation in turn implied that irrespective of what curve I choose, I can parallel transport the vectors. So it means that if you parallel transport the vector from point A to point B, until you tell me which curve you are parallel transporting, I can't tell you the answer. But in any space time, you can do this. Given a curve and a vector at the starting point, I can always parallel transport it. But as I told you, if you do it in two different routes, you will get two different vectors. Okay. Any other questions?